which was that we wanted to make clear that while Athena Moore was talking about a relationship with Inez Dickens, Inez Dickens has not endorsed you, right? So we just want to make that clear. You said support, and people can misinterpret that sometimes. Okay, so we want to make sure we clarify that. I understand there are some other political leaders here we want to acknowledge. Keith Wright, the chair of the Manhattan Democratic Party. Good to see you. I'd like to hear from each of you. If elected, what one committee would you most want to serve on and why? We'll start with you, Dr. Alley.
I'd like to serve on the Criminal Justice Committee.
Yeah.
And I'd like to advocate for criminal justice reform. There is a constituent that lives here in Harlem. I guess I shouldn't say his name, so I won't think about it while I'm talking. And his family came to me because he was charged with rape. When I met them, he was in Rikers Island almost 3 years. They had nobody to call because the fact that he was charged with a
don't
sex
call
crime,
on community board 10.
The lawyers weren't really treating them fairly. They had one lawyer after the next. They had money, so the lawyers were taking advantage, I think, of them. When I stepped in, I went personally with the family to court. There was nobody in the courtroom, just the judge. His name is Derek. Although he was in Rikers Island remanded to prison, he wasn't produced to court. So I got in touch with a gentleman named Dale Wilker from the Prison Rights Project for the Legal Aid Society. Dale Wilker and I, it was myself, Dale Wilker, and his mom against the world. Finally, we got Derek transferred from Rikers Island to 100 Center Street. He then started being produced to court. Fast forward, he represented himself after 4 years of being in Rikers Island with no trial and no conviction, and he was found not guilty in one day. The judge then mistried the rest of the charges. After that, I realized that there are specific things, if we trace the cases, of people that sit in prison and in jails for long periods of time with no trials and no conviction, it doesn't have to be. If we trace the case, we can find the exact things that are going wrong that we have to address to eradicate those problems. So I would like to serve on the Criminal Justice Committee.
And relating to that, I'd like to sit on the Education Committee. Our children are, there is a pipeline to prison process that's happening for our children, and I think that's a direct result of our failing public schools, particularly for black children and other children of color. Our children are brilliant. They're bright. They're smart as any other children. Yet they're doing poorly when they enter into public school. There's not equity in our schools. The programs are not the same. The resources are not the same. Equity is not just dollars. It's not the same amount of money. Equity is sometimes more than that. And more needs to be put into our public schools so that we can equal the playing field for our children.
Thank you.
And on my end, I would like to serve on the Economic Development Committee. One of my key issues is creating jobs within the district. There was a study that came out in a newspaper that showed that over 60% of Harlem residents is a paycheck away from being homeless. This is real, folks. A paycheck away from being homeless. You walk down the street, I see it, you see it. The city has an opportunity to create jobs. And I want to be there to make sure that those jobs come to my constituents in Harlem. And as your next city council person, I promise you, there'll be no projects, no contracts, nothing without minority and women actively participating on the job. Thank you.
The committee I would like to most work with is the General Welfare Committee. I have worked with that committee extensively. Steve Levin, who has endorsed my candidacy as well. I deal a lot. I grew up in Harlem, but not only that, I grew up in foster care. I know the disadvantages that young people face. I know what it's like to languish within the collective unconscious of the American society. I know what it's like to be homeless. I know what it's like to not be able to afford education, afford essential necessities. And what that committee does is seeks to collaborate with different committees within the city council to fix the issues that really ill and stagnate our community. And that's what I am about. Because not only do I have experience within that, but that I have a desire to bring together and to make sure that we are a better community together, pushing forward to not only have better housing and affordable housing opportunities, but to have better jobs, to have better access to resources and community resources so that we are better positioned to excel within the next century. Thank you.
If you would ask me this a week ago, I might have had a different answer, but being on the campaign trail, it's definitely housing. The housing issues in Harlem are so wide and diverse. Seniors losing their home, issues with NYCHA, though that's a separate department. And to try to implement some of the programs that we want to implement, like the housing legacy program and dealing with the TIL issue, I think housing would be the committee I would go for. Thank you.
I would say that, given this is a housing forum, my inclination was to say housing, but the reality is that the issues we talked about tonight cut across with general welfare committee. The root causes that are poverty, economic insecurity, issues of health and mental health that are impacting not only our seniors, but our young people, as well as those who are unemployed and are homeless. Those are issues that we're not talking enough about. And yet we're seeing daily, as I mentioned before, through the storefront, which I operate on 125th Street, I had the ability to help people get public benefit, to get public assistance, to get one-shot deals, to prevent them from being evicted, to help people with gas outages and repairs that were needed for conditions in their buildings, and to make sure that this candidacy helps to restore the pillars of a healthy community. It would require my leadership on the General Welfare Committee. I would also just briefly say that in my capacity as City Councilwoman, I would still be doing, you know, allocation through the budget process, land use issues, policy issues, all of which I continue to have responsibility for now in my current capacity, and I would carry that over to all of the work and all the committees that I serve on.
Thank you. There are so many wonderful committees to be on at the City Council, but to me, it wouldn't matter what committee I was on, as long as I was on the budget negotiating team to make sure that the funds and everything that needs to take place to get back the resources back to this community.
Right.
So what I would say is, it wouldn't matter what committee I was on, but as long as I was part of the budget negotiating team.
I look forward to returning to the budget negotiating team of the City Council. However, to the extent that I have to choose a specific committee as a priority in addition to the budget negotiating committee, education would probably, this time around, be my priority committee. Primarily because, you know, I'm only here because of education in many, many respects. Some of the greater challenges for our future council members and our future senators and other elected leaders or non-elected leaders is going to be determined by what happens in our public education system. And so I would like to be able to give back to that system what I was able to get out of it and become what I've become. And I think as a priority committee, I would start with that. Obviously, the budget negotiating committee is the committee that is perhaps the most important one, because after all is said and done, frankly speaking, it's about the dollars, your tax dollars, and more or less where they're going to go and how they're going to be spent. So that those two are the ones that I think make sense for what I want to accomplish when I return to the City Council.
Thank you. Ms. Simmons.
Actually, I'm very passionate about education and criminal justice reform. However, if we have no housing, it doesn't matter where you are, because you won't be here and I won't be here to be able to assist you. Jimmy McMillan is in the audience. He endorsed me today for the rent to Dan. And one of the things he said is that this is a movement. And just so you all know, we can talk about budgets, and I've been trying to reconcile this, but I'm just going to be honest with you. We can talk about budgets, we can talk about how we need to get more money into Harlem through the government, but guess what? Gentrification is here. It's not going anywhere. And with that, we need to be able to work, and me on the city council, which will work with private sector, with government agencies, nonprofits such as L.A.N.T.E here, and as well as union pension funds. Meaning that those of you here, some of you are in unions. Where are your money's going? Who is investing your money? Why not invest it in real estate within your own community? So that's what I would do. Thank you.
We are coming down the home stretch. I'm told by the organizers I should let you know that there will be food and beverages in the back room after we're done. We will end on time at 8:30, so we have only a few minutes left. I would like to recognize, having heard that the Manhattan Democratic Chair is here, we should give equal time. Adele Malpass is here. She is the Manhattan Republican Chair. Tweeted out earlier tonight, the road to City Hall runs through Harlem tonight. And that is certainly true. We have some lightning round questions for you.
Right, so if you can just please raise your hand if you agree,
then we'll go ahead.
Should term limits for city council members be eliminated? Yes or no?
Definitely, and Inez should never have done three.
Term limits for city council members, should they be eliminated?
No.
Yes? No.
No.
Does anyone say yes?
Oh, we're dying now. Mr. Perkins,
explain. I should have never done three. Destroyed us.
I believe in democracy. I believe that people should decide who should or should not represent them.
They will.
Term limits, I know the story of term limits. I experienced that story, and I think term limits is a determination of you make as to whether or not I should be elected. And if I'm worthy of your vote, or any of us, whether it's me or anybody else, then you should make that determination. That's how we have defined our democracy. And I think that there is an argument about incumbency getting out of hand and corrupt. And I think that we who are the voters, who are the constituency, need to make sure that folks who we elect are unelected if they are not taking care of your business.
Thank you, Mr. President. Do you support increasing the number of city bike stations in the district?
Absolutely not.
Sorry, no. Are there enough bike lanes in Harlem?
They're running you over when you step in the street.
A big part of this is looking at more innovative way of having these things. More bike, city bike, it's not bad. You know, I taught in public school, and a lot of our kids are obese. They don't exercise, they don't move around, they play video games all day.
But they're not free.
The city bike would be an improvement, and you can take advantage
free.
Of it. I think the team needs to look at a better way that will not encumber everyone else. And I think part of it
he's talking about bike lanes and encouraging kids to ride the bike, not so much city bikes.
Thank you. Other locations that folks in the community would be able to access it. But we can't just say no.
for something that would benefit the whole community.
I just think that we can do this vying thing better, but we have to, I believe, foster, promote that type of opportunity for the community. You know, vying is a healthy approach.
So would you, so and slightly different question, would you support exchanging metro cards for city bike passes?
You say exchanging, you mean, what does that mean? Can you spell out
the
bike? No, I don't mind having both. I'm not giving up my metro card.
We're talking about for kids.
Well,
no,
I have a monthly.
No, I'm talking about for kids. I'm talking about for kids.
But you could ride your bike from here to Brooklyn, but it takes you several hours. It's not conducive. I think that you'd be provided the opportunity to have both. And I'll be 100% for it.
On to the bag tax. Do you support the bag tax on shoppers who do not bring their own bags to the supermarket?
I would say no. All right, I have to answer. Absolutely no. There's other issues that we can better focus on. Listen, folks, we have so many different things going on in our community.
What is the money doing?
From a high asthma rate that we see to the joblessness, we're here today talking about housing. This is a serious issue. I just think that is a distraction right now. And let's focus on those serious issues and let's find tangible solutions to them.
However, we're living in an environment where we currently have a mix of educational options, and we certainly need a plan that integrates the best practices in each of those settings, and we need to make sure that the common goal we have, which is higher achievement for our young people, and that is being adequately addressed on both sides, and resources and equity that needs to happen, whether it's at the public school level or the charter school level, has to be a major priority for us.
We got one last question. Opportunity for land use. There are some that have a lot of extra land use that might make sense for some other opportunity, and there's some where such an opportunity would be, I think, prohibited. So I think it's a good question to move to think about and look at the real estate that's available and the situations that exist, but I don't think you can make a blanket statement and say that all of such land should be made available. Because one of the tributes to the public housing situation was open space. People of low moderate income would not be jammed up in housing opportunities where there's no light. Public housing offers a great deal of light. No grass, no playground, no other kind of community-like open space that would be conducive to family life. And so,
I just wanted to speak to you as privatization.
Yes, I just wanted to address the issue of privatization of public housing, because that is an issue that I am certainly generally opposed to. At the same time, I recognize that because of the capital issues and because NYCHA has not always done the best job of maintenance and making sure that the conditions in NYCHA are being adequately addressed, that we must have options that utilize open space and vacant land in ways that can benefit them financially. At the same time, it should not be on the backs of poor people. And if we're going to
and
it should give poor people, low-income people, the benefit first of benefit
funding. I live in public housing. I have talked to my neighbors and people that live amongst me. I live in the public housing. And I can tell you that we are advancing to privatize city land use for other people that does not go back into the community to benefit the community. What we can do is with those open spaces have workforce one training centers and things that help promote economic sustainability and improvement. That's something that I would be for, is to have training programs, workforce one programs that help people to move out of housing to better paying positions, but also to different housing opportunities. If we continue to just keep going along with letting developers come in and then use that space in whatever way we see fit, it is going to continue the migration of people from moving further and further along the spectrum of all until all of us is in the Bronx.
I think it was a big mistake to privatize, to use any part of public housing for any other thing other than
the residents.
Public housing for the residents. Because as we are being gentrified in housing, we're also being gentrified in small business. We're being pushed out of this community. And where it allows, there are some public housing residences that do have commercial space. If there is an opportunity for some small business, small storefronts, training programs like was mentioned, workforce development, and I think the priority should go to people in public housing.
I'm absolutely against giving any public housing to private corporations or developers. What I would like to see more of is what they did up in the Bronx by creating an apprenticeship program for NYCHA residents to move into the trade unions to help rebuild the infrastructure and transit, in NYCHA. I would like to see something like that in Holland. We have a serious plumbing issue in Holland with many of the NYCHA projects, and we should have the city invest more in infrastructure and use it more as a job creation.
Okay, thank you very much. Candidates, this is going to be the last question. And I want you to think of a single act of public service. You've all done many things, but one thing is you want the voters to remember about you as they walk into the polling site on February 14th. And we'll start with you, Ms.
Being a school teacher, just making sure that the children are getting the best education that they possibly can get. And although I didn't continue being a school teacher, just knowing that I advocate for teachers, making sure that they have copy paper so that they can give their children lessons, being sure that we can just do whatever we can to assist the children to go outside of, but get other cultural experiences other than just school and home. So for me, I've always been working with children, wanted to make sure that they're getting the best education, getting the best life experiences as possible, which is why I had the breakfast program in Africa. I volunteered with the Department of Juvenile Justice in group homes, and also in Central Juvenile Hall in Los Angeles. So I would work with the children. Thank you. And I do.
Thank you. Woo! Yeah, the question was, what's one act of public service out of the many things that all of you have done that you want people to be thinking about as they head into the polling site?
The one relates to
not any particular piece of legislation per se, but it relates to the Central Park Five. To me personally, this is in the fight against Donald Trump, who called for the death penalty of five young kids from the neighborhood who were accused of raping a woman in that. And this, for me, was personally the most significant thing that has occurred in my blessing of being an activist and an elected official. Because it reminds me today, every day, that this person is the president of what danger can occur to our communities and to our families if leadership is not honest, and if certain type of prejudices, calling kids wolf packs, and demonizing them and calling for their murder,
I remember
their
that.
So-called,
we wanted them to have the chair.
Death penalty. To me, that's the most significant thing that I can think of. We all have the privilege of being in leadership, whether you support us or not. Have to keep in mind that we are in very touchy water sometimes, and it can make great tragedy, or quite the opposite, if we have what it takes to address it in the right way. So that, for me, is the single most important thing I have to do.
Done constituent service not only here in Harlem, where I'm from, but also in the Bronx and in Brooklyn for the various council members that I work for. So constituent service is making sure that people are staying in their home, making sure the children are getting what they need to survive, and the educational system and youth programs and things of that nature. So constituent service is going to be my goal.
Thank you.
Phoenix rising. And the reason I say that is because through my journey, you've heard me talk about my story, whether it's mental health, substance abuse, the veterans side of my journey. You've heard me talk about being first generation in education. All of those things have helped me to be compassionate and caring in my advocacy as well as in providing expert advice. I'm knowledgeable, I'm on the ground, I've been doing this work for over 20 years. I certainly think that I am the most prepared and ready to start day one in the legislature for New York City Council. And all of the things that I've continued to demonstrate through my journey proves that I am resilient. I will work hard for you. I've already demonstrated through a $27 million allocation through my office that has come into the community to better serve and support you. So I want you to remember me as a phoenix and a phoenix rising. And with that, I will go for you as Harlem continues to rise.
Why couldn't we get a better library than $27 million?
For me, it's more the simple little things. I worked with Dr. Bob Lee on the Make the Great Foundation, and we put radio studios in schools, and we did one on Frederick Douglass Boulevard a couple of years ago. But it was going back to the school recently, and the kids coming in, and then them interviewing me, and how excited they were. So it's little things like that, not so much the big stuff. Yes. Thank you.
I think one thing that I would like for people to remember me is that I'm an advocate for the people, for those who don't have a voice. I worked with city council members to get two pieces of legislation passed to afford greater protections for those vulnerable young people and foster kids to make sure that they're better safeguarded and reputations in place so that our children don't fall for the cracks in agency time. I've worked with Pratt Area Community Council, which is a housing organization that helps people stay in their homes and then provide legal assistance in case that there's an unscrupulous landlord that tries to evict them. I was able to help them get $14.5 million in the budget for all of the Pratt Area Community Council to help people stay in their homes. And then I worked with it even in my own community at age 3, when a young man was killed not that long ago. I went to the school, I talked to the principal and the PTA, and we brainstormed and discussed ways on how we can make sure that our streets are safe, and we came up with a way where we can do a petition and have people in the
in the community, sign on for that police camera to be right up there before you get to the McCormick and the bridge so that people are not sitting excessively and causing harm to our children. I am a person who deeply believes in my community and believes in the potential that we all share. And I don't try to take credit, I just try to work. And that's what it's about. It's working for the people and making sure that we have a better, prosperous future together. Not divided, not young against old, but bridging the path forward together. That's the only way we'll get through this.
I think when I look at this, it's, for me personally, it's more, what do you do outside of your job? Because many of my colleagues here have talked about what they do on the job to get paid for. The senator gets paid to make sure that we stay in our house. So he's not doing anyone any favor.
Talk about you.
Talk about you, though. Outside of my profession, that I've done, volunteer. I volunteer with the community board line. As vice chair, you made sure that the West Harlem Development Corporation was restructured and turned into wise over $80 million worth of contracts, jobs, the not-for-profit organization, and community initiatives. I served, this is a volunteer, as an auxiliary police officer for the 26th precinct because my neighborhood was unsafe, and I felt that the kids in the neighborhood needed to see folks like me, that they know and they respect, looking out for them, and looking out for the seniors. I served as an auxiliary Coast Guard. I've served in all these various roles, not because I'm getting paid for it, it's because I live in this community. I love this community. And after this election, I'll still be in this community. I want to see this community thrive. So when you go to the polls, vote for someone you believe in, vote for someone that has been doing the work without even getting paid.
It's not about
the love, the community. Thank you.
I want people to remember, I am one of you. I have been in this community at a time when most of the apartments in my building were vacant. I've been in this community when we had to go outside to the hydrant to get water. Not hot water, just water. I've been in this community and fought in my building with my parents when we didn't have police services, when we were the tenant patrol, trying to fight off the drug dealers, trying to fight off all the things that were coming at us. We didn't have mailboxes. I don't know if anybody remembers that.
We remember.
And we had to go to the post.